Sorry to invade you.
This is not what it's about.
But she didn't tell me that that's a reason, but I get it.
Until you sent that email, you know what I mean? The mayor kind of mentioned something, but nobody said anything, so I'm like, or Joellen sent it. And I emailed her back and said, you mean we get paid to do this? I had no clue. I'm not doing it for that reason.
So the first person I got, yeah. I was getting reimbursement back on my water bill.
Oh.
Because I don't have any parking ticket.
Uh-huh. Why am I getting a check from the city? Yeah. There she is. World traveler.
She hates me right now.
Cute shoes. Love your shoes. Uh-oh, what have you done?
Well, I'm just getting the runarounds with her, but it's not her fault. It's not her fault.
Uh-huh.
Because
no, it's Natalie's fault.
They will assist us to keep the space and be kind of as necessary.
I'm one of these.
Wait.
If I need to respond, I do it.
Oh.
Because that's my commitment.
I'm certain.
It's difficult.
My fault?
Well, and that's what I tell my employees. The first thing you do if there's a mistake is you own it. And then you apologize,
but I don't.
Then you make it right. Period. And if you can't make it right because they won't let you, then you've done it. That's up to you. But that's, you know, because in sales, we do make mistakes all the time. You upset clients. Most of them, with one or two rare exceptions, will accept.
The same or different?
I just think it's time for the
we ran the wrong
commercial.
Really apologize.
It's on
me. Can we rerun? I worked for a company that we did that. They ran make goods 3-1. Needless to say that they're very few make goods. But because some of it's out of, once it leaves our hands, it's out of control. But ultimately, it stops with the person. You are the face of own it, apologize, fix it. It's not that difficult.
I'll try to capture.
But it's being an adult.
Anything that we might use.
I feel better when I accept the responsibility. It's not blame, it's just responsibility. I'll take it. I will do what I can to fix it.
Hey there.
That's all you can do now. Don't worry about it. You're fine.
Oh, you're kidding. I'm so sorry.
Now my nose is red.
So what part of Florida are you in?
I'm not asking anything. I'm not asking anything because if you ask.
When she gets here tonight, I'm going to share it back.
I know.
Lord. I'm so petrified.
No falling asleep back there.
Because I take chemo drug for real mild, but to suppress my immune system, because I look asleep.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm scared to death. I walk around in fear of.
Yeah. How long ago was the?
I take the injection once a week.
Oh, okay.
It's real, real mild. It's like a hundredth of what they would give a human.
Okay.
But it suppresses my immune system.
Exactly.
So lupus doesn't.
Yeah.
And it's a.
I think there was a reason.
Yeah. That's exactly what it is.
I debated going
addendum.
Back on it.
So it's an addendum.
Because last year, one of my employees decided he'd come to work sick. He could call off anytime he wanted to, but when he was deathly sick, he had to come to work.
I assume Dan will enter this into the record.
Home. He'll
know that he's submitting it to the record.
It's the balancing act of do I want to hurt all over, or do I want to take the chance of being sick?
Yeah.
And right now, I'm opting for the chance of getting sick because I got
kind
of
hurt.
So, but I'm just very, very cognizant of that type of thing. You can't avoid it all.
I didn't realize that.
Yeah.
Especially, and it worked for 5 of us there. So if you're sick, stay home. Why don't you bring it in anyway? There's not enough of it for it when it's forced through the building.
Yeah.
All we'll do is just keep passing it back and forth.
Correct.
And when there's only 5 of us there, there's not anybody to.
There's
not any left, you know.
Starbucks. I understand what you're saying.
But yeah, that's why I live in fear.
Did you talk to Grace?
Not really, because I refuse to, but
I'm still
wary of.
Just hang on to it.
No, I understand.
I was somewhere, I was getting my nails done. last week and the next.
Everything was a little bit to be out. It's really no big deal.
That required you to come out and share
December stuff.
That's my happy.
When we
my happy.
The
It didn't register.
So
then you don't lose it. Well, then it makes it easier when you're taking pictures, too.
Yeah, we were just trying to see if
okay.
It, you know, if it was just
that
cool.
Was Williams' folks. Look for something like that.
He was trying to be nice.
I don't think
I'm
politicians coming out of my ears from last
week. And then I called her home number.
Oh.
But yeah, I must call her on number.
Traveling all the time. Boss, if you wonder why I don't have anything else. Some of them I write, some of them I write together.
No, never, ever,
some
ever,
record
ever,
them
ever,
themselves,
ever,
some
ever.
Record for them, and I just tag everything for my federal paperwork that's involved. And you have to have all of this and put it in order, and then it has to be submitted because it has to be uploaded. Because the FCC put the public file online as well.
Mm-hmm.
So now it has to immediately go in, be uploaded, and go in our
from Jerry.
I think she's responded.
Did you guys hear from Jerry at all?
Yeah.
No. Hi, David. How are you?
Don't ask that question.
I'm doing well.
Hi, David. It's nice to see you.
Nice to see you. Exactly.
The last time I asked you've been fine until anyone else gets it. I'm like, but I'm not asking.
So nobody asks anything.
I'm just saying, hey, you look great tonight.
So should I call her name?
It's nice to see you.
Yes, that's all I'm saying.
Nice to see you.
Didn't do it. I'm like, was it me? I was nowhere near all 7. I did not do this thing. I swear I did.
Need the Lysol.
Because I've been thinking about you for the last 2 weeks, and I'm like, what did I do? Why, what's wrong? What did I do?
I had a lot. I had a hard time, too. I got halfway through it, and I had to stop and let it finish. Although I was at work, it took a while for it.
There's so many pictures in there.
Yeah. There's one spot. I think I had 2 blank pages.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
This weather is going to kill me.
Oh, my allergies are crazy.
My
crazy.
Is insane. My eyes itch and my nose is crazy.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah, the molds and the
it's
air.
Awful.
I'm really allergic to molds.
Beth was in town all day today.
I've got to send her an email.
I'm slowly trying to get caught up. She comes in for the day on Wednesdays. It hasn't been too bad. I think they're taking mercy on me because I can't find a good word for it. Can't find a salesperson.
Did you have Kim?
3 lists. Oh, Lemansky?
Yeah.
Long time before I came. Long time before me.
Where'd she go? She went to the foundation.
Then she went to the chamber, and now she's somewhere else.
She was at the university for a little while.
No, she went to the chamber as membership director for a while, and then Lori came in. Mm. She's out in Hampshire.
I like Lori.
One of my former employees.
Did you not print the triangle? We don't need that. Do you want me to pull it up? It's when you plug it in.
Big time.
I didn't print it.
Okay. Ready?
Sheets, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Something come up tonight. Call to order the March 29th Planning and Zoning Commission. Roll call, please.
Barb.
Here.
Buckley.
Here.
Castro?
Here.
Krull? Wright? Chair Atherton?
Here.
A quorum is present.
Approval of the agenda. Do we have any additions, deletions, or corrections? If none, I'll take a motion.
Motion.
So second. Moved by Buckley, second by Barbie. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. We open up the floor for public participation to anyone who would like to speak on anything not on the agenda this evening. So if there's anyone that would like to speak on anything that is not on the agenda, we invite you to come to the podium. There be none, we will move on to the approval of the February 22nd, 2017 minutes. Any additions, corrections, If there is none, I'll take a motion.
Move to approve.
So moved by Barbie.
Second.
Second by Castro. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. We start with old business this evening. We continue a public hearing on a petition by the DeKalb Sanitary District for a zoning map amendment from the SFR2 Single Family Residential District to the PDR Plan Development Residential District Amendment to Ordinance Number 06-74, Approval of the Plan Development Preliminary and Final Plans and Other Approvals as Required for the Subject Property to allow for the expansion of the DeKalb Sanitary District facility located on 51.84 acres along Hollister Avenue and Sycamore Road. So I open the public hearing that we are continuing, and I ask the petitioners if they have anything they'd like to present. And if so, come to the podium.
Thank you. My name is Mark Eddington. I'm the district manager of the DeKalb Sanitary District, 303 Hollister Avenue. Don't really have anything to present. We've gone through some items that are in the packet. I do have a couple items, and I don't know if you guys are going to present anything at all on conditions. If maybe you want to go through your portion first, and then I can.
I think you could just go and respond to the conditions
okay.
that you want.
We've talked with staff over the course of the last week about items in here, and there's just a few items here under number four, conditions for approval. And I think we've resolved or answered most of our questions here, but I'll discuss them anyway. We've got items B and D, which relate to the admin building and an existing IDOT right-of-way that is going to be, we're asking IDOT to vacate. There was a discussion of whether there'd be a building permit for the building, our admin building would be allowed or not. The building doesn't reside within that right-of-way. Part of the parking lot does reside within the right-of-way, so we sought or we're seeking that we'd be allowed to get a building permit for that building, being that it's not in the right-of-way, and to hold off on any improvement that's in the right-of-way, which would be the parking lot, until that easement has been officially handed over to the sanitary district. So that's one item, and I know we've discussed that with staff a little bit this week. A couple other items, item H, which discusses future improvements, and item Q, which discusses a channel easement and improvements in the channel easement, as it's described here. Those are both items that are going to be part of a larger development agreement. That we just got a copy of from the city this morning, so we really haven't had a chance to go through that agreement yet. But all these items are, I don't want to say redundant, but they're going to be revisited in a larger development agreement with the city that would then go before council. So just wanted to make note of those things. That's it.
Thanks, Mark. So I turn it over to the staff before we open up to the public.
Yes, since the last meeting when it was continued, we did receive revised plans and been working with the district. They've actually changed their name officially to the Kishwaukee Water Reclamation District, so that will be referenced in the future. That takes effect, I believe, May 1st, according to the district. In your report, we include a lot of the same background information. We did add the findings of fact that are required for a rezoning and also for the plan development. So I'll just go over those briefly there in your report. The standards of rezoning talks about that it conforms with the comprehensive plan. The plan actually indicates four different land use categories over that, reflecting the existing land use as a single family. There's a multifamily area there that wasn't built, and a little bit of open space for the park area. We're recommending that the comp plan be part of the sample motion that's provided to the commission to change that to the transportation and utilities category, which currently covers the existing sanitary district property right now. So we think the rezoning is in compliance with the comprehensive plan, and it's recommending that the commission forward on to the council a change in the comp plan to make it one category. It conforms to the Unified Development Ordinance. It's a planned development, so that allows the a development agreement, which was mentioned, is being put together. That will be presented to the council. That includes all the control of the zoning, the development, the maintenance operations of the planned development. The rezoning will not have a detrimental effect on the adjacent properties, adjacent land uses. The majority of the surrounding areas already developed. They're putting into place a lot of provisions to additional landscape buffers. The relocation of the roadway, mindful of the neighbors on that. There'll be less traffic on that roadway with the removal of all the homes on there. And again, there's a development agreement that will control the zoning, the operations, the odor control, et cetera. All be covered in that. The planned development residential district will allow the area, you know, the district to make the expansion that they're planning for, allow for future expansion of the facilities also, and meet the needs of the community and the EPA requirements. And of course, adequate public facilities are already on the property or will be extended to the property to in compliance with the development. There's also in the UDO standards for planned development. And those go over those briefly. We just want to make sure the planned developments are result in about half a dozen items here. That there won't be an inadequate or unsafe access to the planned development. Hollister Avenue is being relocated to better line with 13th Street. There'll be improvements in the crosswalk there, and there'll be a gate just. On Hollister Avenue, just beyond the administration building parking lot access to control access into the property. Traffic volumes exceeding the capacity allowed on the streets. Again, there's about 20 single family homes that will be demolished, so all the traffic related to that now will be removed. And so the traffic on the private Hollister Avenue will be reduced quite a bit. The improvements to Sycamore Road, that is a IDOT road, so they've already submitted plans to them and received preliminary approval. For those improvements and that relocation, there will be no undue burden on the public parks, rec area, schools, fire, police protection. Development will not be incompatible with the intent of the ordinance, and it will not have a detrimental effect on the surrounding area for the items I mentioned before. So in the report, you have a list of the approved plans. There's a development agreement that's being put together that will need to be agreed to before the council acts on this. You have a list of the items required changes and conditions of approval here, and also the list on the back of all the plans that are approved as part of this. Those will have to be finalized and tuned up, so they're part of the they'll be part of the development plan, development agreement document, and kind of the guiding drawings for the project. A few of the comments that were raised by the sanitary district, again, they are moving along, addressing all the comments. We've been working back and forth. They submitted revised comments. There is a they mentioned the IDOT right away. There's a triangular piece. I'm not sure what sheet that shows up on in the drawings, but it's in your packet. But they're working to get that sent or transferred back to the sanitary district. It actually extends in part of the parking lot there. So in the development agreement, we'll have language that will work that out, that the building allowed to have a permit for that. But until that right-of-way is addressed, then the parking lot can't go forward. So we'll develop the agreement to address that. And there'll be provisions regarding what type of approval can be done in the future for the future improvements on the property. They'll be addressed in the development agreement. Be basically they're shown on the plan, but to be determined by the community development director. And if there's any changes beyond that, if significant, then the development agreement will have to be modified, but that will be covered in there. So we do provide a recommendation as sample motion. It's quite long, but it's on page 12 there of your report. Involves the findings of fact for the rezoning, amending the ordinance that approved that townhome project, Parkside Oaks, that was not built in '06. That has to be deleted in its entirety. Approval of the plan development plans, which are on the exhibit. Recommend approval of the change of the comprehensive plan as described. And approval of the plans listed, and then addressing all the comments prior to the city council action, acting on the development agreement. And I don't know if there's anything else, Joel, you want to mention on anything on the conditions or the
Well, I think the district did note a couple of changes that they're requesting consideration of. I was just, give me a second here. On items B, let's see, I was going B and D. Going back and forth between documents here. They were asking for consideration so that the condition did not restrict the issuance of building permits for the administration building. They are correct that piece of right-of-way that they're going to spend a few months with the state trying to vacate is going to take some time. It does not extend into the building. It only extends into the parking lot that's adjacent to the building. So staff has communicated that with them. We're okay with going ahead with the building permit, but we would agree to withhold occupancy of the building unless and until they are able to vacate that right-of-way and replat that area into their own property. That would not, that condition would not extend into the parking lot. We still would need to not allow construction of the parking lot until they receive that vacation. And I believe they're okay with that. So that was item B and D, I believe. H and Q, I'm not sure what exact changes you're looking for. I know we are working on a number of items in the development agreement which provide further clarification to those items. So to the extent that we're going to be working on those modifications with our city attorney, we certainly have no problems with those changes.
That's all. Thanks, Chair.
Okay. So now we open up to the public for any comments. If you'd state your name and address, please.
My name is Jim Schneider, 1139 State Street. Some time ago, I was going to a number of their DSD meetings, and I know these guys pretty well, and the staff has always been very friendly and helpful there. And I've been aware of the development plans for quite some time, and they've been raising their user fees, of course, to pay for this rehabilitation or new facility in over 8 or 10 years, and they've basically doubled the fees we pay as users. And of course, if you want to diminish the use of something, you tax it, and that's what's happened. Is, and the district board trustee president was here at the city council last June, lamenting the fact that the user usage was down, so that their receipts were down, and there's increased interest in conservation. So this came into the press a few weeks ago. I just had some clippings. I just was kind of taken aback a little bit, but how did this come forward at this time? It just didn't seem like it was a pressing need, because the complaint was also we weren't getting development, and so we're not getting usage, and they're not getting revenues. And concept introduced was that this would become a regional facility, and others would send their waste here. And I'd like to have some questions answered about where this wastewater might come from, because this would help pay for the improvements. And what the nature of it would be. Would it be municipal waste, and how would it get here? And I'm concerned that users here are going to be on the hook for this money. It's $46 million, and when the economy busted, the sanitary district was a beneficiary of a stimulus money, which was at least part of it didn't have to be repaid. was federal stimulus money. And that was a great benefit for their first phase to the biosolid phase, which is open now. But I thought maybe that we could talk a little bit more about this regional facility and how this would work to the benefit of users here, because we're basically the payers. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Steve Capitan, 1228 Sycamore Road. I am kitty corner from the proposed administration building. I have a few issues to raise. One with regard to the community, one with regard to myself, and one with regard to the overall economic impact. Regarding the impact on the community, the neighbors, including myself, on the plan, it showed two primary clarifiers, what they were identified as, immediately behind the old bank building and Wendy's. And my question about that is, what is the potential odor impact of those clarifiers? What are they going to be doing, and what potential odor impact would that have on those immediate neighbors as well as those of us that live nearby? With regard to the economic impact issue, as I'm sure the Plan Commission is familiar, when the Elwood Steakhouse went in and the Auto Zone and all of those commercial developments, there was attention paid to linking those different development properties so that they could access the stoplight across from Walmart. And what I noticed was that was not considered with regard to this project. And what I'm suggesting is that the city should require that the sanitary district allow for that to occur. And in looking at the property, it seems like from their proposal, it would be very easily doable, either by moving the staff parking lot some minimal feet away from Sycamore Road, and or the administration building toward Sycamore Road, allowing for the lane to be drawn or to be run from the parking lot of the former bank building to the outside the fence area to access the stoplight, just as we require for commercial zones. Why not, when it's one's institutional and one's commercial, what's the difference, is my question. And to reinforce this point, living there, I can tell you, you can look this up in terms of city records, but over the years, there's been a whole lot of accidents outside there with cars trying to get out of that bank building parking lot. Now, that's diminished since they've been closed for over a year now. But they're immediately across from the Jewel exit, and there have been many accidents there at that in that location. This would that property's been vacant. This would enhance the value of that property for development on behalf of the city, which we need, absolutely desperately need. And so my advocacy would be for that requirement to be put in. And I would challenge the sanitary district to explain why that would be impossible to do, because looking at the plan, I don't see why it wouldn't. There seems to be enough room to very minimally adjust their plan to accommodate it. As far as its recapture of funds from the property owner, that's something that is above my pay grade, but is something that was doable with the commercial properties and should be doable between an institutional and a commercial. One last question. There has been some issue with people. I'm on the frontier of residential. I'm the last residential before the commercial. And when the development of the counseling center was in play, people adjacent, residents adjacent to that were concerned about that. That was resolved satisfactorily. just to the north of that counseling center is a vacant lot and a rental unit that I understand still would remain. Is that correct?
Yeah,
it's not part of the project.
Right, so that would, but that would be, that wouldn't be touched.
Yeah, it's not part of their petition, it's not in their area.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure.
You're right.
That my understanding was correct. Mm-hmm. So the answer, I guess, is yes. But since the residences along Hollister will be taken out, it raises the further prospect of that small piece of property that includes both a vacant lot and that rental unit as to whether or not that would be viable commercial property, because it is screened from the residences by the counseling center. So it is on the other side of the counseling center, and there's no more residences on Hollister. And so the potential for that to become commercial. I don't know in terms of size and practicality, but I would throw that on the table for the city and the plan commission to consider in terms of that zoning as well. So, thank you.
Thank you. I think it would
probably have the applicant respond to these comments.
I was just going to see if there was anybody else that had any comments first. Mark, hang on just a second. Is there anyone else that has any other public comments or questions before we move to answer? That comes up, obviously. Yeah, we won't close it until we make sure.
Okay, I'll start with Jim's comments, okay, and then I'll move on to Steve's here in a second. And some, I think, overlap a little bit. There was a discussion of the economic impact on our thoughts on regionalization. I just want to clear up from the get-go here that our project isn't an expansion as far as capacity is considered. Our project is just replacing the existing capacity that we have and ensuring that it's going to meet, you know, environmental regulations. Now, we do, within replacing the capacity we have now, there is some capacity built in that currently. So we have about 2 million gallons of capacity as we stand today. And, you know, as we're all aware here, residential development or any really development in DeKalb isn't necessarily booming right now. So we want to put that capacity to use. And to the extent we can, you know, be a regional utility, and we're going to be cleaning the water, you know, arguably we'll be producing one of the best effluent, quality effluents into the Kishwaukee River in northern Illinois. We think it's kind of an opportunity for maybe some of our neighboring communities to take advantage of that. You know, if they built a pipeline to our collection system, we would be, you know, we all discharge to the Kishwaukee River. Does it really make sense for every community to have a treatment plant? So I think some of our existing capacity right now could be used for that purpose, and it would really drive costs down to our current customers. You know, there's economies of scale operating a wastewater treatment facility as large as ours. We're the largest facility in DeKalb County, and you know, at one point you just need more customers to drive your costs down. Now, as it relates to cost, our typical family pays $26 a month in sewer fees. So we feel that, you know, while we have raised rates over the years, we've had rates that have been very, very, very low. And, you know, as of May 1, we'll be 20% lower than the city of Sycamore sewer rates. So, you know, we feel we've done our job to provide a cost-effective utility. Does that answer your question, Jim?
Do you have any prospects for additional sources of wastewater from neighboring communities? Do you have any prospects that are definite?
We have nothing definite at this point, but we have prospects.
Well, you pointed out when I spoke to you that Cortland now does not use land application, or if not to the extent that they were.
Chair, could we have anybody speaking up in front of the mic so it can be recorded?
I'm sorry.
Yeah,
Well, of course, they used to treat Cortland wastewater, and then Cortland went their own way, and when they decided to grow and use our capacity here, and so their Cortland system wasn't going to be discharging into the waters of the United States, and that exempted them from a lot of regulations of getting permits. And now Mark has told me that they're discharging now and not spraying like I expected they were, and that means Cortland may sometime want to come back into our system. I'll just let him talk about that and the prospects of that. They've spent quite a bit of money on a system that, well, it was kind of far-fetched that you could just put this up, all this water in the land. What happens is you need a lot of land to do that, because farmers don't want it in the springtime, and they have to collect water all winter long, and then you have wetland and other problems. Mark would talk about that.
Yeah, well, I mean, we'd be open to entertain conversations with any communities where it would make sense for them and make sense for the sanitary district as far as cost and those sorts of things. We just want to open ourselves up as that resource. Okay, to move on to Steve's comments relating to the, like, perhaps an interconnected driveways between the bank and Wendy's and I don't know if there'd be the muffler shop as well over next to it. We didn't include that in our project. I mean, quite frankly, it's not something we really want to have a bunch of traffic rolling, you know, adjacent to or through our, you know, staff parking lot. You know, to the extent we move buildings, we have to move buildings further back. You know, that changes changes where tanks are located. We've got a lot of underground utilities that are kind of crammed in there to begin with. So that was never really part of our, you know, driving thought with our process of designing this improvement. As it relates to the rental, discussing the realignment of Hollister Avenue and 14th Street, any of you have been through that area, we do think this will greatly improve safety of the motoring public through that intersection. It's kind of got a funny kink to it now. I know that intersection in particular, there's a lot of accidents there. I don't have any historical, but I drive by it a lot every day, and it seems like there's always glass out the middle of it. When you mentioned the rental unit was that 1221 Sycamore? Well, that owner did approach the sanitary district last year. He came to this meeting a couple weeks ago, and we've kind of been talking to him. He's interested in the sanitary district buying that property, so he may be coming forward to our sanitary district meeting on the 26th and kind of appealing to our board of trustees, but I don't know where that stands at this point. So
the other question, I don't know if you caught, I'm sorry if I cut you off, sorry,
not at all,
was Steve's question about odor.
Yeah, so primary clarifiers, there are going to be two primary clarifiers are going to be located 100 feet, basically 100 feet off of the back of Wendy's, the bank, kind of the, is it the Parkside Apartments over there as well?
Mm-hmm.
for one, currently we don't have an odor issue now on our existing primary tanks. They don't smell. We've done testing. We're not going to change the characteristic of the wastewater that we have now. We're just kind of moving it to a different location. So we're pretty confident that we don't have odor issues now. We did, however, as part of the plan, we have the plan that's being considered now, an odor abatement system. So there's a chemical system basically able to neutralize odors if they do come to pass. So if there is some sort of change in characteristic of wastewater and there is some odor, we'd be able to handle it. And then, you know, within the development agreement that we're negotiating with the city or will be negotiating with the city over the course of the next couple of weeks, you know, odor is a big subject in that development agreement. So there would be a plan in place that if odor, you know, if for some reason that didn't work, I can't envision that chemical system not working, but if for some reason it didn't, Now, the sanitary district would be obligated to handle odors. It's something we take seriously, and you know, we will take care of it. So.
Thank you.
With regard to odors and primary clarifiers, are the primary clarifiers the greatest potential for odor emission?
On our site?
Yeah.
No.
No. Okay. And I was wondering if you moved them up there perhaps because of the, if you moved them up there because of gravity issues for elevation from the river.
That's exactly right. So right, the way we're set up now, Steve, we pump three on three separate occasions, which is, right, you know, horribly inefficient.
Right.
So we did move the kind of that tankage to the high ground so we could let gravity kind of bring it back to the plant instead of continuing to pump.
That's what I figured. So we're on the same wavelength there. But number one, the driveway would not have to go through the parking lot, number one. Number two, looking at that plan just in terms of the aerial view that was in the backup material, it looks as though the staff parking lot could be moved further away from the Sycamore Road without even modifying the driveway that accesses that staff parking lot, and or reconfiguration of that staff parking lot to accommodate the additional footage required for a driveway. And while, you know, commercial operations might feel the same way, well, they don't need the people's traffic through their lot. But it's good business, it's good practice for the city. That property has been vacant. For that property to be able to be further used, I think it's in the city's interest to have access to Sycamore Road, to the driveway, the Hollister driveway, just as it would a commercial driveway. And I understand that maybe as an institution you're not used to this, but if this is something we require of private business, why wouldn't we require it of institutions, especially when it's in the interests of the city in terms of further use, commercial use of that property? It seems to me that there would be minor alterations that would accommodate such a driveway, and it does not have to go through the middle of the parking lot. It can go right by the edge of the parking lot. And then the other issue that was not addressed was the potential, and maybe that's more a city issue, of the viability of that property for commercial, and that it might be in the city's interest to look at that before the sale is consummated of that rental unit as a further commercial opportunity.
Yeah, that's not, unfortunately, under our purview, so.
I'm just saying in terms of the city generally.
Right.
I'm speaking to both the Plan Commission and the staff.
Right. Understand.
This is in the interests of the city. I'm speaking in the interests of this, what I see as the interests of the city.
No, I understand.
So
we can't answer to that.
Right. Through what channel this goes, it seems to me that those need to be looked at. So maybe I need to be looking over at that table instead of this one. But
yeah,
bottom line is that needs to be examined.
Well, certainly we could look at, 99% of the time, rezoning requests are initiated by the property owner, not the city. So we certainly can look at those two pieces in terms of the comp plan, but that's not part of this request. It's not in the legal description for this request. So that's, in terms of rezoning, that in relation to this project is not under the preview of the commission at this time, so it's not part of the project. So that's certainly something we look at in terms of future planning, comprehensive planning, in terms of what land uses we'd like to see there, certainly.
And then it's
and
on
if
record.
The sanitary district wants to purchase, I mean, that's out of our control, certainly.
Sure.
In terms of the access to the bank, excuse me, to the access to the bank, the property owner has, they have two full accesses to Sycamore Road. They did not request, they received notice, they didn't come to the city asking for a connection to Hollister Avenue. I'm not sure if there would be room in terms of the grading or coming into Hollister Avenue where that would come in. The effect of the sanitary district, they do not want it to cross the property. We certainly encourage cross access in commercial properties, but those usually come in when the commercial properties come in together, or there's a stub provided to the, and there's not a long lane that would have to be added to connect those, so it doesn't really make very much sense. And the bank didn't come to this, didn't ask for any type of connection, and it won't remove the access they have to Sycamore Road, so it won't reduce the safety issue.
How many people here were here in DeKalb 15 years ago? How many people here were connected with the city 15 years ago? Okay, we got zero here. How many people here were connected in some official capacity with any governmental body in the city of DeKalb 15 years ago? You were. I don't remember the precise time. But I was on the city council, and the people that own the property, the bank building property, did seek an access drive to Hollister Avenue. But the neighbors objected to it because the driveway would be going past their houses. It ultimately was not approved. I just thought I'd share that with you. And, you know, it very much troubles me that the attitude from both the sanitary district and the city is looking for ways this can't happen because, well, this is what we've decided and you're disrupting our plans. You're an inconvenience. Please go away. That's the impression I got. Rather than let's take a look at this, see if it's feasible, see what the property owner, if the property owner is it interested in participating. Are you denying that this would not, that this would be a benefit to the city of DeKalb?
I think any cross connection would be a benefit, but it, you know, you have to look at how feasible it is. If it makes sense, it doesn't reduce the safety issue on that property. They still have access to Sycamore Road. They were notified of this request, the plans. They didn't not come forward asking for that connection. The sanitary district indicated does not work within their plans. Maybe they can respond further
on that. I can respond a little further if sure. I can. So we had long discussions with Brian Rosenau, the owner, and the owners, first they wanted us to purchase the bank property as part of the sanitary district property. Really, you know, we considered making that our administration building. That building really kind of wants to be a bank. You know, it would have been difficult. It would have been removed from our the operational component of our admin building, the laboratory and our admin building, it was kind of a bridge too far. We did discuss the idea of an interconnection with the owner from the bank building. So, I mean, those were discussions we had with Brian Rosedow and explained to him the impacts. You know, we didn't go and design the entire thing, but, you know, I'm an engineer by trade, and we looked at the impacts of what it would do, how it would push our building and reconfigure it. And at the time, we just, you know, Brian understood, and we left it there.
I spent 12 years on the city council, and there were more than one occasions in which the professional staff made recommendations saying, it's got to be this way, can't be any other way. The council stood up to them, and guess what? They figured out a way.
Are there any other comments before we close the public hearing?
Let me follow up on something I forgot to ask. Is there a plan B if the EPA doesn't fund this project to the tune of $46 million, or if the EPA direction suddenly changes, we have a new administration in Washington determined to wreck it, and I'm not for that, but things could happen. I just wondered if there's a plan B out there for the sanitary district.
Sorry, I made the mistake of putting two microphones too close to each other before.
Thank you.
Usually I would have screwed that up. So as far as a plan B, I mean, we're doing everything we can to meet our current regulations right now, particularly with ammonia treatment. So regardless of, we have a plant that is, very old. We have parts of our plant that date back to the 1930s that are still in commission. So we're at a confluence of events where we have an old plant, an inefficient plant, and a plant that's not going to be able to meet regulations, that struggles to meet some of our current regulations, is not going to be able to meet some of our future regulations. They're all coming together at the same time. So to the extent we don't get low interest loan money from the IEPA, our intention is to seek $46 million of low interest loan money, pay that back over 20 years. So yes, if we don't get that money and we had to bond it, that would be the plan B, is that we'd have to, go out and bond that. It'd be much more expensive. We'd have to reevaluate our plan at that point. As far as EPA regulations just vanishing and going away, I know the current administration may have a different take on what the EPA does and how they regulate, but there are some local expectations and some local standards that I think this community and this county have, regardless of what the EPA states, that they don't want algae in the water, they don't want high ammonia, they don't want fish dying, they don't want those sorts of things. So I mean, we really have to answer to locally, we have to answer, but we also have to answer to regulators as well. So I mean, as far as there's a plan B, and we have to treat the wastewater, there's no way around it.
Okay, we'll give one more opportunity for anyone who may have any public comment. And I will close the public portion and now open up to the commissioners.
I'm the first one?
You get to go first.
I get the first one. The first thing I wanted to say is on Friday afternoon, I was able to visit the water treatment plant, and Mike and Mark received me. We had a chat about the plant, bless you. And we had a bit of a walk in the grounds while I was there for about 45 minutes. It was very informative discussion and tour of the area. I encourage any citizen that wants to understand modern society to go to a place like this. If we didn't have sanitary facilities, water treatment like the ones we have, we will be a very different place to live. Thank goodness for the Romans that give us an idea about aqueducts and stuff like that. I have a few questions just to put things in context, and probably Mark, you may be the one better equipped to answer my questions. When we talk about EPA regulations, normally the EPA forces us through the law to meet standards. They don't force you at a lower level of standards. Normally these things take time. They don't impose a regulation and they tend to be realistic about when you have to meet them and stuff like that. Could you give us a little bit of the context of the regulations that may be driving this particular project?
Yes, they're very deliberate. For the most part, they're very deliberate with regulations. And at this point, we've never seen any backsliding of regulations. Drinking water and wastewater are a little different. Drinking water is pretty set. I mean, the regulations are what they are. Wastewater, it's almost regulated to the limits of technology. So as technology improves, they expect you to discharge a higher quality effluent. That's how this industry typically works. We operate under an NPDES permit, which we receive from the federal EPA. It's administered by the state of Illinois EPA. And each five-year cycle, we get a new NPDES permit. So there's an application process that we go through, and then the feds come down with kind of your new rules of the road. To speak to your point that they're deliberate with how they, you know, the rulemaking goes and more stringent effluent standards and those sort of items, typically you'll get a permit, and then you'll get your permit like we did last time, and all of a sudden you'll see you're monitoring something that you didn't used to have to monitor. In our last permit that was issued, that was phosphorus and nitrogen. So typically when you get your permit, you're now monitoring something you didn't monitor, that's a big star that says, hey, next permit cycle, don't be surprised if you're now removing, now you now have a standard to remove whatever that contaminant is. So as we move into our next permit cycle, which is this year, so we'll be receiving our new permit some point this year. Our current permit's up on May 1, so we're kind of waiting any day to get our new rules of the road from the EPA. We expect some sort of nutrient standard, which when I say nutrients, that's phosphorus, nitrogen, and we expect a more stringent ammonia standard. So basically our current ammonia standard is likely to be cut in half, and we do everything we can to meet our current ammonia standard with our existing facilities. Like I was saying, some of the treatment process dates back to the 30s. So we see the writing on the wall. Illinois has been talking about phosphorus treatment for the last 20 years. It's one of the only states that doesn't have phosphorus. You know, there's a handful of states that don't have phosphorus standards. So this is something that larger plants in the state of Illinois are going to receive these sorts of standards first, and they will work their way down to the smaller community plants. So hopefully that answers your question a little bit.
And that starts answering my question. And it gives us a sense of the time scale here. Could you give us, I see this and it looks to me like a major project within the DeKalb Sanitary District. This is no small potatoes. Correct me if I'm mistaken. This is a big thing.
We've been talking about it for 15 years.
And that's where I wanted to go. This is a project that you have been talking about for about 15 years. Formally, has it been on the books for?
We started design 2 years ago. We started property procurement almost 6 years ago.
Okay.
I guess it would be 5 years ago when we started purchasing properties along Hollister Avenue.
So it comes to us, to this commission specifically in the city of DeKalb at a general level, in a formal way. It comes in recent weeks and months or so, or years. Correct me, please, if I'm mistaken here. But this is something that has been going on at the public level in the district for at least 5 years. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. So I just wanted that for the record, just to understand or have an idea of the magnitude of this project on the one hand, and this is something that has been out there for quite some time. I'm curious to know, and I know that there has been some turnover in staff, but I'm curious to know whether you have any idea for how long you have been aware of the city of DeKalb being aware of this project.
I know at least last year that they approached the city. Mark could correct me regarding the proposed plan and what steps would have to be taken regarding to get the approval, but
I mean, we started by approaching Mark Bernacki when we originally had conceived the idea. We were starting the purchase of the Hollister Avenue as kind of our properties as part of our due diligence. We approached the city at that point, said, hey, this is out there. We see the writing on the wall from regulations. We have parts for our plant that are beginning to show signs of age and are beyond their useful life. This is all going to come together at the same time for our next large project, which is this phase 1B biological improvements. So yeah, okay. We've worked with, you know, these folks for a long time, their predecessors for years, and you know, three different public works directors. So we go back a little ways talking about it.
Thank you. I think that's what I wanted to clarify. Thank you.
Yep.
Yes, sorry, I'm a little bit at a disadvantage. I wasn't here the last time, the last meeting. So I just have some information or questions. It's just about the plan and the streets, like what is now Hollister Street, that will completely disappear. Will that be green or what?
So if you're looking at the drawing, kind of the overall,
I'm
yeah.
looking
if you're looking at
the drawings are confusing. This is much easier to.
Yeah. If you're looking at that particular drawing, Hollister Avenue as it is now would be vacated. The houses would be demolished, and kind of the access, Hollister Avenue would kind of turn into the access road into our treatment plant now.
So you kind of have two access roads then? Because you're building this new road too?
I
don't know. It seems to me like Hollister goes this way, and then there's Hollister is going away.
Hollister will go away.
Okay. Yes. Mm-hmm. I'm just wondering about these parts here.
I should have brought a drawing.
Go ahead. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. See these parts?
So this is existing Hollister
yeah.
here.
And that would go
this
away.
This is, well, yes, that'll go away.
Okay.
And that'll be, you know, there'll be piping and green space and
okay.
those sorts of things. Oops.
Yeah, this thing reacts fast.
And this would be the new access road. So this little piece here would continue to be Hollister because that would be public.
Mm-hmm.
This is a public building. And then we'd have a gate here to
okay.
try to keep public out of the operating
plant.
Yes.
Yeah.
So the public would be able to access this building for board meetings and to do public business, and then you know, we'd have the plant secured. Currently, the way we operate now, our admin building is here.
Okay.
And you have to drive all the way into the plant, so you have folks coming into the plant. You don't even know they're there until
they're actually there. Yeah.
They're there, mm-hmm. and it's not the best setup.
And then the people who live on Kirpen Court and have
yep.
have they
yep. so these,
done
yes.
any input?
We've had a lot of input.
Okay.
We've been meeting with the Kirpen Court residents for probably over a year. We met with them. We said, hey, what do you want? You know,
mm-hmm.
this is what we're doing, and we asked them what they wanted. They wanted a robust landscape buffer. So that's what we're proposing, much similar to how we've done around other parts of our existing treatment plant. We actually border the other folks on the other side, south side of Kirpen Court right now, and we have a 40-foot tall, you know, line of conifers. They don't even know we're there. So we're going to do something similar. We've already started planting those trees already. We're going to be planting additional trees this spring, and we're going to keep the existing tree line that's, you know, the trees in the backyards of those Hollister Avenue houses that are along our shared property line. We're going to keep as many of those trees in place as possible. So
yeah, that was about it. I just some information. Thank you.
Don't sit down because I have a question. So my question is about this right-of-way with IDOT. So obviously, we know things can take time. Do you have, or have you been given an estimate about how long it may take for IDOT to get to you on the easement or the right of way? Like, and what happens if they come back and say, guess what? We're not giving you this easement. Would they do that?
I suppose we could condemn it.
Okay.
We have the right under, you know, we're organized under the Sanitary District Act of 1917. We can condemn any property that we want. I
okay.
think they'd probably just want to get rid of it. I mean, they're not in the business of wanting right-of-way and maintaining right-of-way that they don't absolutely need.
Because they would have to maintain that
right.
property then, correct?
That would be my assumption. So I would assume, just like, it'd be great to get rid of liabilities, right? I think that's probably a liability. They don't really need it anymore. The way it's that intersection is going to be reconfigured, and the way we're dedicating right away to IDOT is part of that reconfiguration of that right away. So I assume, I mean, crazy things can happen, right? But my assumption would be it might take several months. I think it's something we can work with IDOT and make it happen.
Okay. So with Hollister. Given the fact that that's not really going to be a road, so to speak,
Will that be renamed? Is that going, I mean, obviously you're going to want to have an address to.
Good question.
We might already have an address. I'm not sure if it's going to be a Hollister address or a Sycamore Road address, to be quite honest with you.
That was just a curious question.
Yeah, we're going to be 1401 Sycamore Road.
Okay.
So for old time's sake, maybe we'll keep that little stub public portion of Hollister. I think we'd probably
kind of
like
down
to
at the bottom of the building or something.
Right.
Just to
confuse people.
That was a curious question. But as we got to talking tonight, I thought, you know, that's the one thing you hadn't talked about was if that was going to be renamed or.
I think we just intend on leaving that little public stub, Hollister Avenue.
Okay.
Of course, I've always wondered why it's not 14th Street, why it changes.
Or why it's not 13th.
13th.
Was it 13th?
Yeah.
13th, rather.
Yeah. Okay. That's it for my questions right now. Okay. Anybody else? Mm-hmm. Okay. Any
Thank
further
you.
Comments from the city?
No, we don't have any. The sample motions on page 12. Is everything else, John? Yeah. Okay.
You can have it.
All right.
Go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
Well, you go ahead. So, I just want to say before we get into the motion, I appreciate the comments that have been shared, especially not just here, but we had comments from citizens over the course of the night, I don't know, a month, 6 weeks ago, when we had the open session that you guys came in, the information session that you guys came and presented was very informative. I learned quite a bit that night about methane gas, which, you know, I think the piece that informed me was that the fact that you're going to produce your own electricity at the plant eventually, which is awesome. I'm a product of, my dad was a wastewater treatment plant operator over in Rochelle for a little while. So I know quite a bit about wastewater treatment plants, but a lot has changed over, and as you said tonight, it can change every 5 years or every couple of years. So all the work that has been done in this, as David said, over the course of 15 years, 20 years, whenever you guys started this, I appreciate it. I'm sure the commissioners appreciate it, and the citizens will appreciate it as we get going into this. So I just want to put that out there to thank everybody for all the input that has been given. So with that being said, I will be happy to take a motion from the commission, one of the commissioners.
I'll move the motion.
Okay.
Based upon the submitted petition and testimony presented, I move that the Planning and Zoning Commission forward its findings of fact as outlined in the March 24th, 2017 staff report to the Planning and Zoning Commission and recommend to the City Council a zoning amendment to Ordinance Number 06-74 to delete in its entirety approval of a map amendment from the SFR2 district to the PD-R district. Approval of plan development preliminary and final plans and approval of the DeKalb Sanitary District plan development prepared by W.E. Hanna Surveyors, latest revision dated 3/21/17. Approval of an amendment to the 2005 comprehensive plan by designating the subject site under the transportation and utilities land use classification in order to allow for the expansion of the wastewater treatment facility for the subject property in accordance with approval plans as listed in Exhibit 1 and subject to the required changes and conditions of approval listed in Section 7 of the March 24, 2017 staff report prepared for the March 29, 2017 Planning and Zoning Commission meeting. The approval includes the following waivers from the provisions of the UDO. Number one, a garbage dumpster located on the west side of the lab administration building will be located without enclosure. And number two, chain link fence topped with barbed wire will be allowed around the perimeter of the property except where ornamental fences provided were visible from Sycamore Road as indicated on the approved plans.
So we have a motion by Buckley.
Second.
Second by Castro. Roll call, please.
Just make a comment. There were some discussions on the conditions in Section 7. So part of the motion is as revised the conditions. So if the first and second would agree to that.
Okay. Yes.
Okay.
In Section 7, I'm sorry.
Revised in Section 7?
Right.
Yep.
And the second agreed?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Second.
Roll call vote. Thanks. Barb?
Yes.
Buckley?
Yes.
Castro?
Yes.
Kroll? Wright? Atherton?
Yes.
Motion passes.
So we just starting on page.
Okay.
What page is that?
Page. So we will start on page 100.
100.
Yep. Okay, so the next item, I gotta start. I gotta get on the right page, sorry. Thought I was there. Where's the agenda? Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, so the next item is an item under new business. There we go. Which is a public hearing on a petition by Kelly Williams and Company, represented by Russell Anderson, for approval of a special use permit for a gasoline station and approval of a variation to the lighting standards in Article 10.05.01 in parenthesis 2 of the Unified Development Ordinance to increase the average ground level, foot candle levels, and other approvals as required to accommodate the proposed use on property which is zoned GC, General Commercial District, and located at 1020 North First Street. And so we have a presentation by the petitioners,
yes.
Correct? If you'd come to the podium, state your name and address, please.
My name is Russell Anderson. I'm legal counsel for the applicant, Kelly Williams & Company. My address at the firm of Williams McCarthy is 120 West State Street, Rockford, Illinois.
If you could pull your microphone down just a little.
I apologize.
There you go.
Is that better?
That's a little better. Yep.
Okay.
Thanks.
And I must say I've got a little hoarseness and cough that my son gave me this weekend. So excuse me. I apologize.
What's going on? No problem.
It's pretty
Thank
irritating,
you.
I'm sure. The property location you've identified and the petitions that we have submitted you've summarized today. Just briefly, Kelly Williamson, the applicant, is a family-owned company that was established in 1932, owns and operates over 40 gas stations, convenience stores in southern Wisconsin, Dane County, Wisconsin, northern Illinois. The closest owned facility here is in Cortland, and they've had that for several years. They're also a bulk distributor of commercial, industrial, and agricultural lubricants and fuels. So I've been representing the company probably for 30 years, and I can say that they believe in quality and excellence in their facilities and in their service. They are very employee-friendly. Their employees have been on the job with Kelly Williamson for a long time on the average. It's a very good place to work, and they really take their responsibility to the community and to the industry seriously. They've been recognized by Mobile Refinery as a very successful and well-run operation under the Mobile branded flag. The proposed development on this site at 1020 North First Street is an unattended self-service gas station. Using the latest technology and systems required by the Office of State Fire Marshal, including automatic notification of fire departments, shutoffs, and the site improvements will consist of 4 canopy covered fueling islands for gasoline. The south island will have a diesel fuel dispenser. There'll be a small building that will be for equipment operations and the district manager's office when she's there. And she is a DeKalb resident. And a restroom with an ATM. There'll be full video surveillance systems, and they are accessible. And we were talking tonight about accessibility by the police department of all the video cameras that would be appearing at that site that would cover all of the islands, the building, the grounds. this would be a fully landscaped facility. I don't know how well you can see it on the screen. The top picture is a rendering of the facility as it's to be constructed, and I apologize that it's a little dark. you can see the canopy will sit on the long way north and south along the boundary of North First Street. The bottom picture on the slide is the way the property sits now. It's been in that condition since the client acquired the property and started its remediation. This site has been a gas station for three decades, starting in the 60s. It was owned by a local individual who had mechanics bays and gasoline. Kelly Williamson purchased the property from Mr. Breeze in 1994 with the intention of immediately demolishing all the improvements and removing the tanks and starting construction. Unfortunately, the reports that were given to us did not reflect the condition of the property, and as a result, remediation had to start, which has continued over a decade and a half and has now been resolved with a no further remediation letter issued by the Illinois Environmental Protection Agency, which allows the current development. My client is excited about being able to use the property after all these years and and becoming a part of the DeKalb community. The next picture is a demonstration by photograph of the newest facility in Rockford, Illinois, that shows the construction and color of the brick of a trash enclosure. There will be a trash enclosure on the property. The brick, and Greg, if you'll, Greg has an actual sample of the brick, which is a, I'm partially colorblind so to browns and greens, but it's supposed to be a gray color, and it's smooth surface. And he can show that to you. All of the construction at Kelly Williamson is very high level. The next screen is a sample informational photograph that shows the color and the composition and nature of the brick. The same brick will be on the building, the small building, which is about 216 square feet, the trash enclosure, all of the columns for the canopy all the way to the top, and the base of the corner pedestal sign. In terms of the pedestal sign, we have a depiction of the size of the pedestal sign. We, in our original submission, the name of the bank that's running the ATM was Alpine Bank, but they have we've substituted BMO Harris Bank as the bank that's going to run that because Alpine just thought this was too far out of their territory. but in this, picture shows a red base, but this is going to be a matching brick, the same gray. we think that the gas station in this GC district is compatible with the existing commercial, retail, and office uses that already exist in the area along both Hillcrest and First. That's also, this use is consistent with the comprehensive plan for commercial development. This site has had a long history as a gas station. My client would like to continue that use. across the street, there is an existing operating gas station. There's also a former gas station that has been empty. I don't know how long. I can't tell you that. the quality construction that is part of every station that's constructed by Kelly Williamson Company will be actually an improvement to the character of the neighborhood. It'll be modern, it'll be attractive, it'll be fully landscaped. It'll be masonry construction with brick facade, as I indicated, on all the outside surfaces of the building, the canopy columns to the top, and the trash enclosure. This facility has historically had four access drives, two on Hillcrest and two on First Street. We're closing the ones closest to the intersection and leaving the ones that are clear at the edge of the property, both to the east and to the south. So it'll be a safer traffic pattern for intersecting with the street. This is a picture of the gas stations that appear across the intersection. And the one on the top is the one I think that is not presently in operation. In addition to the special use, we're also requesting a variance to the lighting standards. You have in your ordinance a maximum foot candle average for the site at grade of 5. Because of the, and we have submitted a new photometric plan that's dated March 24th, 2017, that was also prepared by Red Leonard Associates, who prepared the first photometric study, which had higher foot candles shown. The plan was revised based upon using the same LED, high-end LED fixtures as are proposed and approved for the Casey's store on Peace Road. These are efficient and focused lighting fixtures, and similar to what we understand per the report, the maximum level under the canopy, directly under the lights, under the canopy, will be 36.9 foot candles in the middle of the canopy. The reason we can't achieve the average at grade of lighting is because the site is so small. The canopy as a result is smaller. There's not enough area for the light to be measured at distances. So it's the existing small site, and this is an entire lot 30 of the subdivision. This isn't just part of the property that was carved off. This was as planted. Customer safety and security have become, in our business, very important to our customers. The bright lights that are focused down on the dispensers are something that provides some sense of security and awareness by the customers of their surroundings. And we don't want to diminish the lighting to the point that people feel insecure about walking in or driving into a dimmed facility. Actually trying to meet the standards, I'm not sure that given the goals and operational needs for safety and security, that it would actually be possible to come up with a plan that would meet the maximum 5 foot candles average throughout the site. The change in the lighting standard by granting the variance really has no material impact on the off-site street or adjoining properties. And this you cannot see, but the Red Leonard March 24th photometric standard shows the readings not only under the canopy in the upper left-hand corner, but also out to the edges of the property, where it doesn't take much more than the second rank of numbers, where most of the numbers are well below 5 foot candles at those particular spots. So while our average is high, I think the focus of the illumination on the property is within the working area of the development. This picture shows schematically, and if you had access, you could run a slideshow, of the nature and intensity of the lighting. And you can see that depending on the nature of the display, the lighting, especially on the bottom pictures, does not disperse even to the edges of the property in any significant fashion. The staff has proposed conditions on Exhibit A. The applicant agrees to all the listed conditions to the granting of the special use and the variance. It has no objection to fulfilling those. With respect to the standards and for special use and variation and the findings of facts in the staff report, the applicant agrees that they are accurate and material in their findings, that we would urge the commission to adopt these findings and approve the special use for the gas station, and also adopt the findings of fact for the variation and allow variance to the lighting standards per the photometric plan dated March 24th, 2017, prepared by Red Leonard Associates, which we most recently submitted.
Okay, thank you. I turn it to the staff.
Yes, thank you, Chair. You have in your packet the staff report, and the applicant went over very well what they're requesting. Just a few items to note. Right, the site layout, there'll be, it was a former gas station many years ago. It is a small site, but it is a subdivided lot. They're not further reducing it. They're cutting down the number of access points from four full to two full, furthest points away from the intersection, which is good for safety. They did provide a truck template showing how trucks that deliver fuel will enter the site, and they'll enter off of First Street from the north, and the underground tanks are at the northeast part of the site, and then they'll exit onto Hillcrest Drive. There's restrictions on the bridge on First Street south on the Kishwaukee River, so they will not be able to go south. So they did show templates showing how they'll get in and out of the site there. It's unmanned, so there's only one required parking plus a handicap space, which they show on the site, and they show the building with the trash enclosure and landscape the site. They do provide landscaping meeting the UDO requirements. They are going to be instead of berming along First Street and Hillcrest, which is not enough room to get a berm in, they added additional shrubs. In addition, they'll be sodding that area instead of seeding that at our request. They indicated the ground sign, and there's also signs on the canopy, which they'll have to revise to reduce the size, which they've agreed to that. Findings of fact, and we have two here sets, one for the special use, one for the variance. Of course, reminder, the special use is a recommendation from the commission. The variance is a decision by the commission. For the special use of the gas station in the GC district, I have findings of fact in the report, but it complies with the surrounding area of GC and LC zoning in the surrounding area of a similar exact same use to the north, right across Hillcrest, in a former gas station at the northwest corner of that intersection. They're meeting all the UDO requirements instead of the lighting. It will not dominate the immediate area, will be compatible with the surrounding area. There's commercial uses all around the site. They provide adequate utilities to the site already, so that should not be an issue. Regarding the findings of fact for the variation on the lighting, I provided at your desk tonight the addendum to the staff report. As the applicant mentioned, they did revise their photometric plan to reduce the foot candle level. The UDO has maximum average for the whole site of 5 for commercial properties. Their initial plan had an average foot candle of 14.08 and a maximum candle level under the canopy of 62.7. So that was quite high. They went back and looked at their number, revised it, and reduced it down. So the average foot candle is 9.07 and the maximum level under the canopy is 36.9. So all these numbers kind of don't mean much. So as a comparison, I just noted what Casey's had, which they met the ordinance. They had just under 5 for the average foot candle. Now that lot was 1.6 acres. This is 3.38 acres, so it's a lot smaller. So there's more room to disperse the light, and so their average was lower. But under their canopies, it was about 32. So, and we had our consulting engineer take a look at this. They provided some recommendations or best practices for foot candle levels for gas stations and agency or association that looks at that. They recommended about 30 foot candles under canopy, so they're pretty close, and they did reduce it quite a bit. But I think the key is, in terms of the variance, it is a smaller site, so their average is going to be a little bit higher, plus there's adjacent commercial all around it, and residential is quite a distance away, so it should not be affected. So I did provide a sample motion on the variance. Again, that's a separate motion than the special use, but approving the reduction in the or increase in the average ground level foot candle from 5 to 9.07, and that would be per the photometric plan that was provided also on your desk tonight. Also provided was, as the applicant mentioned, the color of the brick proposed for the utility building, the dumpster, the piers under the canopy, which will be brick, and I guess the sign too. They provided that revision, so that is noted here. Then Exhibit B was revised in the staff report that lists all the plans approved. The photometric plan was revised to get the current date, the one you have in front of you, and also the brick color detail described here is included on item 8. That would be for the building trash enclosure and canopy piers. And I guess you indicated that would be for the ground sign too, the base. So if you want to make that part of the motion, you can do that also. So. All I had, Chair. Thank you.
Okay, so I open up the public portion to anyone that would like to make comments. And I see one public here. Do you have any? You're the public here, so.
It's all I do. I forgot to mention before at the previous comment.
Sorry to interrupt.
Steve Capitan, 428 Sycamore Road, DeKalb. I forgot to mention at the last session that I really appreciate indoor plumbing.
Me too.
It is often taken way much too much for granted. So I wanted to get that on the record.
So on the record.
But with regard to this, I didn't catch all of the issue on the lights, but my only concern would be that the lighting is carefully directed downward. That's my main concern. I'm not raising an issue with how much intensity of lighting you want within your property or even slightly adjacent to, but it's the directional stuff, and I'm hoping that there's good technology to really make sure that it is directed downward. So that's all.
Would you want to? Yeah. Just so we have it on record.
Russell Anderson. Yes, all of the lighting fixtures under the canopy and the pole lights will be LED focused small lens lights, which are directed straight down. They don't have any side panels with dispersion of light at the source. It's all straight down from the small LED, high efficiency, very expensive lighting fixtures. Very expensive.
Cheap. You save on electricity, which is what we want.
Okay, thank you.
If I may make one other comment.
Sure.
With only one restroom, we will not be contributing a great deal to the restroom. And that's a problem with such an affluent society.
But at least there's indoor plumbing.
Oh, Lord. We've really gone downhill.
Thank you.
We're going down the path.
You know, we have to have some humor in our meetings. If we don't. Okay, so I do want to give one more chance for any public comment. And with that, I will close the public portion and turn any questions to the commissioners, and I will look to you first.
I just have, again, informational questions. Oh, am I not speaking into this thing? This will be credit only, right? No. Cash too? It said cash and credit, so then this just works like a machine, like a Jewel when you do your own checkout? Okay.
Interesting.
What about security? Are there cameras?
Could somebody go to the podium,
okay,
please? Just so we can hear you on record. And you're on TV, so we have to have the public hear you too.
My name is Bob Sanderson with Kelly Williamson Company, 1132 Harrison Avenue, Rockford, Illinois. Yeah, we'll have security cameras there. We'll have everything on each of the pumps. We'll have the lot under surveillance, so everything will be secure. They'll have money acceptors on there, so we'll be able to take cash, credit cards, the speed pass.
Okay.
All that will be accessible. Plus, we'll have an ATM, so we'll be given a cash discount if somebody wanted to insert cash there, so they can use the ATM to get cash if they wanted to.
So I'm watching too many crime shows.
So
do you save the tape for a certain amount
of
time?
Yes, yes. Okay. They have up to 3 months of the stuff we'll be using, so that'll allow us to go back. So if we did have some activity with credit cards, we can actually go back and take a look what was going on out there.
So I looked at the picture and it looks really nice.
Uh-huh.
So are you really going to have that beautiful landscaping? Looks
yes,
much nicer
yeah,
than my backyard.
Yeah.
And
yeah, thanks to the Planning Commission there.
And who's going to maintain it?
We will maintain it. Okay. We'll hire a landscaper that'll take care of it.
I drive by that nearly every day when
okay,
I go to
excellent.
The Y, so I'm going to watch this.
No, that'd be
and
fine.
See this
oh, yeah. Yeah, we'll take care of it. We'll maintain it. We'll have somebody there every day. They'll empty the trash, fill all the stuff. Our manager, we'll have a manager there, come in the morning, work for about an hour, and then we'll also have somebody there just to help customers get familiar with everything. The first couple, probably about the first month, we'll have probably somebody there for 4 hours just to make sure they understand how everything operates, because we want them to use it and feel comfortable being there.
Well, I'm all for it because it's nice to have something that's an ugly place right now.
Yes. Yes, we would like to do something.
The whole corner is ugly.
Huh?
The whole corner is ugly.
Yeah.
All for it. But yeah. So yes. Maybe it's a story. Thank you.
Yep, you bet.
So don't go anywhere.
Okay.
Sorry.
Yep, no problem.
Oh, yeah, I thought you were going to say something.
I was, but usually I'm last. So I will, off that question about the being able to take the money in. So how many other facilities do you have similar to this facility?
We have three operations. We got three in Rockford, Illinois that we're using.
That are?
Yes.
Unmanned? Unmanned. And
yes.
Interesting.
We have the one there by the Schnucks grocery store by Cherry Valley.
Oh.
We have one right in front of our office there on Harrison. And then we also have one out on Meridian Road that we're doing.
I guess I never pay that close attention when I stop to get gas, because I think we're in a society that we're so used to swiping credit cards or using the speed pass that, unfortunately, I don't realize there's nobody there. You know, there's not a body there taking money or whatever. So
I have a site that we took over that does the cash, and we have the C-store, but actually a lot of people just go to the pump and they leave. They don't come inside. It's becoming that kind of society anymore.
Okay.
So.
Okay. I think you asked mine about having any other unmanned, and I believe you answered one that I had about why that corner and not the one that already has the pre-existing gas station, but you've had the property for
had it, yes.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. We wanted to use it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Just a side comment, where my business is located, we were neighbors. We shared a parking lot with Kelly Williamson for a long time, and I can say they did, you know, a really good job with that building while they were there. Yeah.
Now it's my turn. All right. So this is what I think is a small typo, but I think it has implications for the meeting, so I just want to make sure that it is a typo. In Section 6, Conclusions and Recommendations, your second sentence is, especially use will be in space compliance?
Under the variance?
So your recommendation.
What page are you on?
I'm on page 6.
Okay.
Page 6.
Okay. You are in space compliance.
What number was that? I'm sorry.
So 6 at the bottom is the very last sentence on that page.
Yes, in compliance with the UDO.
In space compliance.
Yes.
Okay.
Sorry about that.
No compliance. Just want to make sure.
Yes.
For the record.
In compliance, okay. Yes.
I want to understand your recommendation, make sure that I get it right. Second. Uh-huh. So I agree with the first commissioner that spoke in the overall idea that we're going to have a better corner when this is complete. And I was interested in this whole lighting issue. I understand Mr. Capitan's desire to have this focused lighting under the canopy. And in fact, that's what, you know, results in a really large gradient. You know, if you stand on the corner, I'm looking at the plans. If you look on the, if you stand on the corner versus under the canopy, you have a huge difference in the lights. Now, you said, and this is going to be my question at this point, I am confirming, you had an engineering consultant that looked into this.
Yeah, our engineer, WBK Engineering, has a lighting person, I guess, or expert. You know, they do a lot of development, so they took a look at, and they used a association. It's noted in the addendum here, the Illinois Illuminating Engineering Society of North America, IES, and they have recommendations for lighting and.
Okay.
So roughly about a 30-foot candle under the.
That canopy. Was under the canopy. If I'm
not
mistaken.
Didn't have an average. They had other, you know, approaches into the site and which they met, but so just to give an idea of, you know, is this lighting reasonable? Is it
correct.
Average for a gas station?
In the recent, so when I was reviewing this documentation during the weekend, the question that came to mind and maybe being answered right now, you tell me if not, is whether this is an opportunity to improve the lighting in that area, particularly on the area where people would be walking, particularly at night. Again, compared to what is there now, we're going to have a better situation, no question about it. But I assume, and I hope my assumption is correct that when you have an engineering consultant looking from the outside, this looks good. And he's thinking about safety, and there's going to be more lighting on that walkway and so on and so forth. I'm assuming, and please tell me if I'm, does that make sense? What I'm saying makes sense?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's going to be more.
I drive by that corner all the time at night.
You're concerned about the sidewalk. Along
exactly.
That. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, there'd be more lighting certainly than, I'm not sure.
Than the current
situation.
There
might be a street light there now, but
yeah,
there's more there.
There's something,
yeah.
But not
the
a lot.
The stoplights put off quite a bit of light in that area too, but yeah.
Ironically, you'd end up looking, you know, red, green, or yellow. Mm. I understand exactly what you're saying.
Yeah, yeah. But, and there is
okay,
some.
Okay, I'm glad that a consultant looked
yeah.
at this from the outside just,
yes.
just for
yeah.
that. That's a concern. Thank you very much. I'm good. No, I'm good, yeah.
But this is also where the kids who go to Clinton Rosette, that's where the guard is, right? Right at this corner.
Usually.
Yeah.
Usually,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's a crossing
just because
the crossing
that lot's
guard.
Open.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But now, well, I think they hang out. I think they park at both corners. Mm-hmm. But there's, yeah, that corner will be open still. I mean, but yes, that is that corner. I did have one question, actually, Dan. Just some clarification that in my head I wanted. You had made a comment about the signage on the canopy. And I don't know if I just was not paying attention. That there's going to be a change to the sign on the canopy?
Yeah, one
what
of
is the change?
Conditions is, or one of the UDO requires for canopy gas stations, there's specific regs for that. One sign per every two faces, so they have three canopy signs shown. There's a detail of the canopy.
Yeah.
And
it's just the mobile. It's
the
not
mobile part, yeah,
okay.
Not the
okay.
color. So, and then they'll have to reduce the size slightly. And they've agreed to that. We just haven't received revised elevation showing that.
Okay.
But it is one of the conditions in the report.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure
yep.
that I was. I know there are some canopies that have the digitized signs too, and I wasn't sure if that's what you were talking about. Okay. All right. Any more questions, comments?
Nope.
I agree that I think that's going to be an improvement to that corner.
I agree too.
Especially with the flowers.
And yeah.
Just the light alone will be an improvement.
Exactly. So with that being said, if there's no further questions, I think we're ready for a motion. Just a reminder about the brick in the motion to make note with the change in the brick that we had noted.
Yeah, there's two motions, two, one in the special use, one in the variance. The Exhibit B that was revised relates to the special use. Item 8, you could add the ground sign to that list with the new gray brick that you saw the detail.
So from?
So the motion for the special
Belgium
use on page 7 is set. You can do that one first.
Oh, okay. So the brick that's listed in Exhibit B is the correct brick. Is that right?
Yeah, under item 8, you could just add the ground sign at the end there. They're going to do the base
canopy
of the ground sign
ground
with
sign.
That brick that you saw the detail on.
Okay. So did you guys catch that? So in Exhibit B, under item 8, at the end of that sentence, you should add and ground sign. Whoever does the motion.
Exhibit B, number 8?
Yeah, Exhibit B, number 8 that was handed out. You can add the ground sign handed out tonight.
You know what, though? I'm not noting
yes.
an Exhibit B
sorry.
In our notes.
No, it's not in the notes. The motion in the notes is the
Exhibit A. Mm-hmm.
Exhibit A, item 1, references Exhibit B.
Oh, gosh, it's too complicated.
Exhibit A, item 1. Oh.
References.
Which lists all the drawings that are approved.
Exhibit A.
Okay. Yes. All right. So Exhibit A was in our original backup. And in line number 1 in Exhibit A says the development of the night of the site shall comply with the drawings indicated on Exhibit B. In Exhibit B is where we have the addition in number 8.
What page are you on? What page is
this? Number 8 of 9 in our original backup.
There it is.
There you go.
Too many pieces.
So when you make the motion, excuse me, just note that Exhibit B that's noted in Exhibit A has a change to number 8 with the addition of the ground sign.
Okay. Exhibit B is different than yours.
That was the original one. There was one they gave us tonight.
Cool. Alrighty.
Yep.
That'll help. There we go.
Oh, it's the last page.
Come on. That's the one we got today. It always is, isn't it? No matter what we do, it's always the last one. Alright. Found it. It's motion.
So we'll have two motions that we'll need to make. A motion on the special use permit and a motion on the variance. Correct?
Yes.
Yes.
I'm gonna attempt the first motion.
Go ahead.
Okay.
Based upon the submitted petition and testimony presented, I move that the Planning and Zoning Commission forward its findings of fact and recommend to the City Council approval of a special use permit for a gasoline station to be located at 1020 North 1st Street, subject to conditions listed in Exhibit A. Exhibit A makes reference to Exhibit A, point number 1, makes reference to Exhibit B. And I want to note that we are, that reference, Exhibit B, I'm sorry, is the one provided today, the 29th of March, which contains an 8th point brick color detail from Belden Brick with gray bricks, label 661 smooth for the utility building, trash enclosure and canopy piers, and
ground sign.
Thank you very much.
Motion as amended. A motion is in play by Castro.
Second.
Second by Buckley. Roll call.
Barb?
Yes.
Buckley?
Yes.
Castro?
Yes.
Kroll? Wright? Chair Atherton?
Yes.
Motion passes.
If this is the other one,
the variation. This one.
And the variance sample motion is on the bottom of the memo addendum I handed out tonight.
Yes, I can move that.
Yes,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. See, I missed that one.
This one.
So I hope I read the right thing.
Yes.
Okay. So based on the submitted petition, testimony presented, and finding of fact, I move that the Planning and Zoning Commission approve a variation to Article 10.05.012 of the Unified Development Ordinance to increase the average ground level foot candle level from 5 to 9.07 on the property, subject to the following condition. The lighting for the subject site shall be developed per the photometric plan prepared by Red Leonard Associates, dated 3/24/17.
Excuse me. The motion is in play by Barbie.
Second.
Second by Buckley. Roll call.
Barb.
Yes.
Buckley.
Yes.
Castro.
Yes.
Kroll. Wright. Chair Atherton.
Yes.
Motion passes.
Reports and items for the next meeting.
Next meeting will be April 12th. We'll have a public hearing on, I think you got emailed on those, Kishwaukee Country Club with rezoning and annexation, and also a rezoning on Blackhawk Drive, K-1. campus in this. So we have the hearings on April 12th on those. And kind of follow up from previous discussion, we'll be changing the council will be looking at approving the meeting dates starting in May for the Planning and Zoning Commission. We'll meet on the Wednesdays prior to the council meetings instead of after. So that will take effect starting in May. And once that schedule is approved by the council, we're looking to print out the next meeting on April 12th. We'll get you a copy of that that schedule for the rest of the year.
So when are they scheduled to vote on that meeting change?
April 10th.
Okay. So we should know about that at our next meeting?
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you.
So I will take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
So moved by Barbie.
Second.
Second by Castro. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Motion passes. We are adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome back to DeKalb.
Thank you.
Oh, you can have your bricks up. But we wanted to take those home.
No.
Have a good week.
Thank you. You too.
See you in a couple. Please.
Healthy, hopefully.
Stay away from me. Don't talk to me. I'm not going to talk to you.
No questions.
We're,
no
we're
questions.
We're all fine. We're all fine. See you guys. Have a good one.
Bye.
There is a non-zero chance that I will not be here at all. So I will confirm.